A person whose career shows the wisdom of that is our first speaker, Andrew Flesher, who is a designer with Andrew Flesher Interiors. He has worked on projects ranging from homes in Utah to apartments in New York. He has an office that is both, he has an office in Minneapolis as well as in New York, and has done residential and commercial projects worldwide. He's a graduate of our interior design program, and he has been featured in a number of home decorating magazines. So please welcome Andrew Flesher. Andrew.
Thank you. I'm not sure if it's better to go first or worse, but thanks for coming tonight. It's really an honor to be here and to be asked to come here. To be honest, immediately after agreeing to speak, panic set in. Figuring out what I was going to talk about was not easy, but one of the great things about that is that it forced me to reflect on my life and my career. I've been practicing interior design for 23 years now, and I really hadn't taken the time to do that until this point. I thought about how I got to where I am and the things that affected me and influenced me, and I thought about how I became interested in design and how that interest was cultivated and nurtured. This is a photo of me at age 7. Look at how uncomfortable I was. My dad wanted a hockey player. I was his only son, so you do the math. I remember how much I hated playing hockey. I even remembered hiding when it was time to go to practice, thinking that if my dad couldn't find me, I wouldn't have to go. And for some reason, that never really worked. It wasn't that I didn't like the skating aspect of the game, but the rough energy of it and the other boys almost scared me. I would rather have been drawing or painting than fighting over a small black disc. Maybe I would have been better figure skater than a hockey player, I think. Well, the other boys seemed to pick up on that, and I felt different, but at the age of 7, I didn't really understand why. It wasn't until I transferred schools in junior high that the bullying started. I was new, it was a small private school, and I was different. They'd all been going to school together since kindergarten, and I was a fresh target, and the kids were ruthless. During that time, I felt extremely isolated and alone. I couldn't tell anybody about it because I was 12. No one talked about being gay at that time, in my world at least. And I was afraid if anybody knew, I'd be rejected, even by my family. Instead, I took my refuge in design. And my initial interest in it came from a couple of very important people in my life. There we go. That's my grandma Irene. She was not a typical grandmother. She was Italian. She was feisty. She had a great sense of humor, and she was very progressive. She was interested in fashion and style, and she wasn't interested in wearing an apron or baking pies. I remember she'd pick me up in her white convertible with red leather interior, always wearing a skirt, black and white spectator kitten heels, and she'd pick me up to see a movie and then we'd go for pizza. That happened almost every weekend. For her 93rd birthday, I was having trouble finding something to give her as a present. She always would say, "Oh, don't buy me anything, I don't need anything." And after much persistence, she said maybe she'd like a subscription to InStyle magazine. That was at age 93. She lived to be 95, and for her 95th birthday, I threw a party for her. I was living at 510 Groveland, and that was before La Belle Vie was in the lounge, and I had a party for her there. But I picked her up at her condominium. She was still living on her own, and she came out. She was wearing a very beautiful tailored suit. She had a colorful silk scarf tied over her shoulder, and when she came out, I said, "Grandma, you look beautiful. I love your scarf." And she said, "Well, you know, thank you. They're wearing it like this now." So another person that influenced me was my mom. We used to joke in our family that her wedding vows were to love, honor, and redecorate every 3 years. And this was not an exaggeration. We always had a project going on, whether it was a kitchen remodel or adding a bathroom or redecorating or just an addition. She was very creative and loved art and painting. She used to say her style of decorating was early attic, but she would always get compliments on our house. She could see potential in things that other people couldn't. She also allowed me to have opinions about what was going on in our house and the projects that we would have going on, and she listened to me. I was constantly redoing my bedroom, painting it, moving the furniture around, doing different things to it. And I remember once she let me pick the wall color for our dining room. I was 13. It was terrible. She didn't have it changed, at least right away. Maybe like the things in our attic, she saw the potential in me to be an interior designer. So to take my mind off of what was going on in school, I would draw house plans. I'd get graph paper and I'd draw a plan and I'd imagine myself walking through the house. And then I'd elevate it. I'd pull it up on elevation and I'd put windows where I thought they should be. I'd always ask my parents to buy me home design magazines and house plan books. And I'd look through them and I'd critique them and I'd appreciate the things that I really liked, but I'd think, oh, what would I do differently if this was my house? I'd also ask my parents to drive me to open houses on Sunday so I could go through them. And when they couldn't, I would ride my bike there just so I could see what was inside of some of these houses. So these things help me to take my mind off my worries and also hone my ability to visualize space. It really benefited me as I continued my education and got into my career. As the years passed and I finished high school, I decided to go to the U of M. I started taking pre-architecture courses. After all, in my mind at that time, men didn't become interior designers, they became architects. So after years of taking history of architecture classes, physics and calculus, I realized I loved the design part of architecture, but I hated the science part. So architecture was close to what I wanted, but not exactly. And so I started bouncing around from lots of different majors, trying to find things that were related to houses, which is what I was interested. So finally, my mom said to me, you know, Andy, she still calls me Andy, men can be interior designers too. And that was all I needed. I knew as soon as I took my first design studio class in the College of the College of Home Economics at the time, from D. Gunther, that was exactly where I was supposed to be. I was on the right path. After graduating, my career took off seamlessly, effortlessly. I worked hard, but it didn't feel like work. I was doing and continue to do what I love. In Buddhist terms, this is called flow. Oh, I'm almost done. Since then, I've been blessed with many wonderful clients that have invited me to help them find their refuge in their surroundings, a place to find peace after being assaulted by the day, just as I have found mine in design. To this day, when I'm having trouble with anything in my life, design is my go-to to relieve stress. It's where I find solace in beauty and what design represents to me, hope. Although I had a difficult struggle in my adolescence, from that struggle came one of the things that has given me so much joy in my life, and for that I'm truly grateful. Thank you.